Hi, I'm Marty Nemko. What you just heard in the background, that woman saying, "Ooh, it's a good boy," was, there's my dog sleeping, and there is my very small studio audience as I'm about to play one of my concerts. And this is very different because I decided to make a list of everything I really like to play the best. And that's what we're going to do. And it's 45 minutes or so. Of course, if you don't like it, you can just press stop and go do anything else. There's lots of choices on the internet, but I hope you'll enjoy this. Anyway, okay. Oh, something you may want to know if you're not regularly a follower of me. I used to be a normal 10-fingered piano player, and then a few years ago I developed a hand condition, and unfortunately I can't straighten that finger, nor this finger, nor this finger. So you're essentially going to be listening to a 7, maybe 8-fingered piano player. And I say that to you not for sympathy, but because we all have had crap happen to us. And we all sometimes just get depressed and give it all up. And sometimes we say, damn it, I am going to fight this thing. And I've tried to, and hopefully my piano playing will be a bit of inspiration for any of you who've had crap happen to you. Hopefully you can see the keyboard. Was the right response. Okay. Barbara Streisand, when she did her famous concert in Central Park, started with, "I don't know why I'm frightened," because she's done so many things before. And I just had the privilege of seeing the amazing, the Bay Area's, she's won many awards as the best singer and performer and actress. Her name is Dani Beam. And she did the same song, "I Don't Know Why I'm Frightened." And I'm playing this for you in her honor. I also love the song. It's a gift. You know, I don't deserve any credit. I can't read music. I was born doing this. I did it. This is all by ear. If I played it again, it would be completely differently. I grew up in a tenement in the Bronx with my parents couldn't afford any piano. They were new immigrants, Holocaust survivors. Wow. But my mom walked me down to the backyard the vacant lot. And there was an old broken down piano in New York. It's rained on and snowed on and whatever. And the kids were banging on it.
Oh,
and I'm 4 years old, and I was watching transfixed, and I said, you know, this is, I got to try this. And I started to play chopsticks. They were playing chopsticks. So I tried chopsticks and by ear, and the first few notes, oh, that's wrong. Maybe that's right. And I kept trial and error getting feedback, and I was able to very quickly pick it up. And because I don't read music, I never let my ear atrophy. So every time I played, I was playing along with the radio. I was in the 60s, The Witch Doctor or Yellow Polka Dot Bikini or whatever. And I would play along and I would say, oh, that's wrong. That's right. That's wrong. That's right. And that developed my ear. And that's how I learned to do this.
Yeah.
Right. Anyway. Okay. Enough of that. I just mentioned that I learned to play by following along with the radio, but that was frustrating because the radio would only play the song once. So I started to buy records. The very first thing that I made my parents buy was a hi-fi, you know, before stereo, and right with a record. And it probably wasn't the first record, but the record that I most remember playing along with, and I still can't play as well as him at all, but I kept trying to imitate him, was a guy named Peter Nero. And Peter Nero's, one of his songs was People from Funny Girl. And here is my attempt this day to imitate, but it's still not as good. If you Google Peter Nero People, you'll see he plays it better than me, but it's reminiscent of that anyway. And what's notable about him is he merges popular style with classical. And you're going to hear some of that too in the middle. There'll be a little classical feel to it. Play interspersed with all these wonderful classics by other people, some things I wrote. This one, I'm a career counselor, and in between clients, I will often go to the piano and just play whatever comes out of my head. And this melody just came out of my head recently, and this is what it sounds like. Thank you. just hold on. I don't know, what's the name? What should I name it?
Reminiscence.
Reminiscence. Okay, well, there it is. It's Reminiscence. Anyway, I apologize. I'm supposed to turn down the, so you can see my fingers. After I talk, I'm supposed to turn down. I forgot to do it last time. See if I can remember more often. Anyway, when I was young, I guess I will tell this story. I've never been social. And so I would, believe it or not, be somebody who would go bowling alone, even when I was 12 years old. And I remember coming out of a bowling alley when I was 12, and across the street there was a little storefront that said Stephen Scott Orchestras, which was played for weddings and bar mitzvahs. And a little, you know, pisher that I was, 12 years old, wasn't even shaving. I walk across and I was curious, and I see a piano in there. And I say, what is this? He says, well, we play for weddings and bar mitzvahs. I said, can I play for your orchestra? And he laughed. And he said, sure, kid. Why don't you play the Shadow of Your Smile in F sharp? Well, fortunately, I can do that. I can play almost any song in any key. And I got hired that day. And I played over 2,000 weddings and bar mitzvahs by between 12 and 22. It was cool. Anyway, a little insider secret. Bands, when they play, you know, in a wedding or bar mitzvah, they get more money if they are hired to do what's called continuous music, which is, instead of the union required 20 minutes on, 10 minutes off, it's 55 on, 55 off. Well, it's really, what they do is they stretch out, because most of the orchestra doesn't want to play that long. So they had me sit and fill in with long pieces while the rest of the band took a break, and it was still called continuous music. Anyway, the longest piece I played, I'm going to only play a shorter version, was MacArthur Park. And here's MacArthur Park. Thank you. You know, speaking along, the words were something about baking the cake out in the rain, and there was all, you know, this was in the 60s, and everybody was saying, man, he was probably stoned out of his gourd. Really, what there really was, this was a guy walking in MacArthur Park in Los Angeles, and there was actually a cake that was left out in the rain. There was no big stoner significance to it. That really was the case. And he, for some crazy reason, Richard Harris, or whoever wrote the damn thing, that wasn't put it in the lyrics, but I digress. Okay. I wrote a show for a woman, and the climactic song, it was very much a feminist show, she wanted it to be, and so the climax song was from Wicked, Defying Gravity. It was all about, screw the wizard, I am a woman, I am strong, I'm gonna fly. And so here is Defying Gravity. I can't sing, but this is the music.
I think we saw that show.
So did I, it's a wonderful show. Of feminist anthems, the most, maybe most popular one from recent years, from the Disney movie, most of them are feminist these days, Disney movies, which is from Frozen, Let It Go. Thank you. Did see?
We know the song.
They didn't see Frozen.
Oh, you didn't see it. Well,
no. But we know.
It's empowering. Very much empowering.
Is it?
Oh, for women. Anyway, girls. Much, much older. My two favorite movies, probably of all time, I guess because I am a musician, Sound of Music and Fiddler on the Roof. It's funny, a very Christian one and a Jewish one. So my favorite song from Sound of Music is Climb Every Mountain. Okay, and now the Jewish version, a little medley of Fiddler on the Roof. Thank you. enough of the secular, enough of the religious, I guess. Secular now, back to the secular. I want to try an experiment. I need a volunteer.
Uh-oh.
Who wants to volunteer? Come on up. I want you to play any three notes on the piano, and I will riff on those three notes and see what the hell comes out of my fingers.
But constantly three notes?
No, just three notes. You can go...
And that's it?
Just three notes. Then you, and I will try to...
Then I sit down.
Then you sit down.
Oh,
and
I can constantly three.
No, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay.
So it's probably easier to come around this side.
Okay.
And just play three notes somewhere in the middle, and then I will try to play improvise.
Okay.
Just put your one finger, just put on three notes, any ones you want. Okay. Thank you. Probably can tell, but I've always been nerdy. I mean, everybody, you know, when I was, you know, a teenager, everybody was into the Stones, man, we're getting high and all the rest of it. And what was I listening to? You won't believe this. I swear, I mean, this is no exaggeration. Nothing I've been saying is an exaggeration. The Lawrence Welk Show. And there was a pianist who was a ragtime, honky-tonk pianist who who I tried to, again, I'd listen to and try to play along. And the most famous ragtime or honky-tonk song ever was Scott Joplin's Maple Leaf Rag. And, you know, I will try, you know, ever competing to be the best, I will try to play better than, I've listened to Scott Joplin's version and I've listened to Joanne Castle's version, that's the woman from Lawrence Welk, and I have at least aspired to try to play it better, see what happens. But because we'll try to channel Scott Joplin, it's over 100 years ago, and so I'll have to start slowly, and just maybe I'll be able to speed up at least a little. I had a radio show on NPR for 30 years until I should have not got kicked off, but they did for horrible reasons. Anyway, bottom line, I occasionally played the piano on. It was mainly an interview show, and I did 3-minute career makeovers where people would call in with their work problems, and I would help them try to come up with a solution in their problem within a few minutes. But in any case, I once had a guest on, and he was a world-famous orchestrator. He wrote the arrangements for movies. And I played one thing for him that I had written, and he said, "Geez, this sounds like it's your Jewish heritage. It's like from the old klezmer Jewish days. So I'm going to play that for you." And he's right, of course. I didn't realize, it was not conscious, but it's there in my DNA. Taken from an Asian woman, I'll take that under advisement. Okay. Well, maybe the best known classic standard song, not classic, but standard song in the world is Over the Rainbow. Mm. So here is Over the Rainbow.
Oh, I love that.
And what I'm going to encourage you to listen to is what maybe makes this a little different than the way other people play it. Listen to the chord changes. I really try to play with not just the standard chord changes, but maybe a little more subtle, maybe a little more interesting chord changes.
Original.
Yeah. I want to do the same thing with another very popular old standard, My Funny Valentine. And I think what I'll do is I'll play the verse as well, which is less known, but it also gives me more chance to play weird chords. Okay. I think I'll lower this a little more. Okay. Getting to the end here, I thought maybe I would take a request. What would you like to hear me play, if I can try to do that?
Can you play Girl from Ipanema?
Yeah, Girl from Ipanema. Did I put you up to that?
No.
You know, you would think that maybe. No. Oh, right.
That's. I love that song. So.
Okay.
That's interesting.
I didn't mention it to you before. I didn't say, ask me that. Okay.
No, we just conjured it up.
Okay, fair enough. Okay, now, two last things. One, in honor of my mother, who died not so long ago, almost 90. That's why I inherited my musical. She could not play. She was a Holocaust survivor, so she. It was taken away as a child, so she could never learn an instrument or whatever, but she loved to sing, and it was just who she was. And her favorite song was Autumn Leaves. So here is Autumn Leaves, including the verse as well. Thank you. And now last, I think I want to end with something I wrote. This I wrote specifically, not wrote, but dreamed up in my head to, fancy words, recapitulate, duplicate the process that my career counseling clients tend to go through. They usually come in sad. They don't come in to see a career counselor because life is perfect. And we start sad, and then we slowly make progress, and then we get a big win. And then usually then they're back to being peaceful, but much more pleasantly. And this music attempts to mirror that process. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for coming.
Thank you for having us.
I'm going to turn this video off now.
All right. Nice selection. It was a fun thing to do.